to see the fruits of his works, reviving the deen and holding to the Sunni way and spreading the love for Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, teaching the deen, leading the Muslim communities. It is one of the great blessings of these scholars whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send in our communities every now and then to revive the hearts of the ummah and bring Muslims back to the true path of Islam. Today we're going to speak about one of these great mujaddids of our ummah, one of the greatest men of Allah, one of the greatest scholars, one who left behind him an impact that if you are to analyze it and evaluate it, you would put him amongst the top 10 most influential Gnostics and Sufi masters in our Islamic history. If we are to pick up the most 10 most influential in their teachings and in reviving the Muslim Ummah over generations, you pick up someone like Sayyidina Shaykh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani radiyallahu ta'ala an. You pick up al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Shadili, Mu'in al-Din al-Shishti radiyallahu ta'ala an, Bahauddin Naqshband, Sayyid Ahmad al-Rifa'i, Sayyid Ahmad al-Badawi, Shaykh Ahmad al-Tijani. And amongst the top of these, there comes Imam Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli rahimahullahu ta'ala wa radiya an. Great people whose goal was not just to teach a group of people around them in their community. They did this, but they were concerned about the Muslim Ummah, the state of the hearts of the Muslim Ummah. They see the weakness, they try to address it. They see where Muslims are suffering, whether in their hearts, diseases of the hearts, they put the treatment. If they see lack of attachment to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they write what is needed. They see lack of following of the great fuqaha or great ulama, they write. And Imam Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli rahimahullahu ta'ala did this. Although he taught, he had 12,665 disciples, murids, when he died. And this is in a small village in the Atlas Mountains, mid-south of Morocco. Small village, not in the city of Marrakesh or the city of Fez, which shows you the impact. People were coming from the region, from around all the region, just to pray behind him. He established a zawiya, a masjid, and a madrasa. He raised up these 12,000 plus disciples with firm, correct aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, top Sufi behavior, as you are aware. Tasawwuf is adab, tasawwuf is akhlaq. They say, التصوف أخلاق. فمن زاد عليك في التصوف فقد زاد عليك في الأخلاق. ومن زاد عليك في الأخلاق فقد زاد عليك في التصوف. He produced, they say, 12,000 plus disciples, 12,000 plus arif billah, 12,000 plus murshids. Imam al-Jazuli rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiya anhu. Maybe we should put things in their historical context so that people are aware who is Imam Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli. He's from Morocco, from Sousse, a region mid-south of Morocco. He was born before year 800 of Hijra. That's from now 644 years back, in a coastal village called Tankrut, from a family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a Sayyid, a Sharif, whose lineage goes back to Mawlana al-Imam al-Hasan ibn Ali alayhim as-salam, peace be upon them. He received his education in his village, as usually common kids in every village, there is always an imam and a teacher, a kuttab for Al-Quran Al-Kareem, the basics. And this is one of the things that people in this country, Muslims in this country, should always bear in mind. When I see communities like this with so many ulama, I'm so happy. But sometimes I go to communities, they don't have ulama amongst them. And it is forbidden in Islam to stay in a place where there is no one to teach you and your children Al-Quran Al-Kareem, or to answer your questions about Aqeedah. And the ulama discussed how far this should be. They said, Masiratul Qasr. If there is no scholar of Aqeedah in Masiratul Qasr, you have to migrate from there to where there is a scholar who can answer your questions in Aqeedah. Even in some of the fuqaha said, if a people of a city or a village do not have a teacher to teach their children Al-Quran Al-Kareem, then the governor, the Muslim governor in that village, will force them to bring a teacher and take money from every family against their will. The discussion was whether they should pay equally or the wealthy pay more. This is in fiqh. So we see now how much we need. Muslims migrated from the 60s, 70s here, I mean mass migration. And often they didn't bring with them enough scholars till later. And now the new generation is growing, and there's not enough teachers to teach the youth and save them from the evil of these societies here, to protect their deen, to answer to their needs. Because a young man in at the age of 15 or 16, he needs a teacher who understands him at the age of 25 or 30. And then a middle-aged man who is in 40 or 50 will need a teacher who is the same age or older. It's just the approach. So, Alhamdulillah, when I see a community like this, I turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thanking Him for providing these scholars, and I have a lot of hopes. So I hope that the next generation, the youth amongst you, every one of you, please, in this masjid, every one of you in this community around here, wherever you are, you go to the masjid, take your children with you. Tempt them with everything. Give them the best rewards, the best pocket money. Everything is, if you come to the masjid, pray, you get this. If you pray Fajr in the masjid, you get this. If you memorize Juz'u Amma, you get this. If you do this, all of the motivations are around this. Because a lot of people do it for the sake of dunya. If you get high marks, be in your school, then I give you this, I send you on a vacation. No, we want, this is the first. This is the most important thing in our life, which guarantees our survival in the dunya, is to have our children growing in the masjids, having these memories in their life. Our children are being destroyed now by the media. First of all, in the past decades, by the TVs, and now by social media and other YouTube channels and something like that, where they have access to all of this, Now imagine these images all in their minds. What is good therein other than in the masjid, in the mawlid, a qasida in praise of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a beautiful song about Islam and Iman or the Sahaba or Ahlul Bayt. This is how we need to protect our children. In the past, our ancestors understood this very, very well. And any child from the age of four or five would be sent to an old lady in the quarter, Khuja we call it, in Syria from the Turkish tradition, where he learns Quran. When he is six or seven, then he starts, you know, shouldn't be around women. Then he's sent to the Kuttab, Madrasa for children. And in the Madrasa for children, then he received the basic education. That was most important. Then he goes to schools or he goes to the farm to help his parents in the farm. So Imam Al-Jazuli followed the tradition. His father was taking care of him. And his father is Abdul Rahman, Muhammad ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Bakr ibn Sulaiman. Sulaiman is his father's grandfather. And as you are aware, usually a person is named after a certain grandfather because he's more famous. Like Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam running between the two armies in the Battle of Hunayn, the closest to the enemy, saying, أنا النبي لا كذب أنا ابن عبد المطلب. أنا النبي لا كذب أنا ابن عبد المطلب. Because Abdul Muttalib was more famous than his father, Abdullah. There's nothing wrong in doing this. So Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli, his father took well care of him, good care of him, and he memorized Al-Quran al-Kareem. He studied the basics of knowledge needed to qualify him for higher studies at Al-Qarawiyyin University. Al-Qarawiyyin University, as you may have heard, is the oldest university in the world. Older than Cambridge, Oxford, Uppsala University in Sweden is 540 years old approximately. Al-Qarawiyyin is older than all of these universities, and it was established by a woman. This is the beauty of and the legacy of women in Islam contributing. I came across a manuscript. The information of it in the catalog says it is al-sihah of Imam al-Jawhari, Ismail ibn Hamad al-Jawhari, most famous dictionary. Amongst Arabic dictionaries, al-sihah is like Sahih al-Bukhari amongst the books of Hadith. Ismail ibn Hamad al-Jawhari, genius scholar. He tried to invent flying before anyone else. And he tried to fly from the roof of the masjid in his town he understood the equation, but he fell and died. They said he was nuts. He was genius in every area of science, including mechanics. Ismail ibn Hamad al-Jawhari. A woman wrote a copy of his dictionary in Baghdad. Her name is Fatima. And at the end she wrote, if you find any errors, please forgive me, because I was writing with my right hand and helping my baby sleep with my left hand. This is an example of the brilliance of women in Islam. So again, Fatima also, Al-Fihriya, is the one who established Al-Qarawiyyin University. And the educational system in Islam is unique and much better than any educational system today. Scholars who studied in circles around the ulama, they understand this. When you study with the ulama, there are no exams, because your teacher examines you every class. The teacher doesn't let you out of the class unless he makes sure that you understood the class very well. It's amana, a trust. Even if the class is going to take longer and longer and longer. We have examples from Al-Muzani, student of Imam Shafi'i. He wasn't brilliant in the beginning. Imam Shafi'i continued teaching him and persisted on repeating to him until he became what he became. And many other examples. We don't have exam systems, because every class is related to another class. You study grammar, then whether you master the grammar or not, it will be known in the class of balagha or in the class of fiqh, because the teacher will ask you to read. And the moment you make some mistakes, he'll tell you go back and study Qatr al-Nada again, or Al-Ajrumiyya again, or Al-Alfiyya again. It's a beautiful system. People now study for the sake of exams. They set their exams not to talk about cheating, all these type of things. Okay, we assume everyone is honest. But people study for the exams. After the exam, they forget everything. Because the goal is just to pass the exams. Not to take this knowledge and benefit from it throughout your life. Muslims didn't have this system of setting exams at all. And in these great centers of learning, like the Umayyad Masjid, Al-Azhar, Zaytuna, Jami' al-Zaytuna in Tunisia, Al-Qayrawan, every grand mosque in every big city, Al-Fatih Masjid in Istanbul, you go there, you pick up your teacher, and you pick up the subject you want to study. Often, you studied a little bit before, so you don't have to start all over again. There's a teacher teaching Ajrumiyya in grammar, and another teaching Qatr al-Nada, another teaching Alfiyat ibn Malik. You already studied Ajrumiyya, so you just sit with the teacher teaching Qatr al-Nada or Shudur al-Dhahab. You don't need to repeat first grade again. Now the teacher will examine you from the first couple of classes. He sees that you're up to a higher level, he tell you move to a higher level. When you enter the masjid or the jami'ah or the madrasa, you get a book. So the teacher has to sign for you that you passed. Ijazah is called. Ijazah. بذلك الكتاب, that you studied this book and you mastered it. You work, then you can pick up two classes every day, one after Fajr, one after Maghrib. But you're full time, you can pick up even seven classes if you have time for that. So you can finish actually what you study. People study now for 12 years to get to unis. And these 12 years are just waste of the most brilliant, most important years of the youth. You get people graduating now, they don't know how to write, let me speak about English, a perfect, an eloquent letter in English. In Arabic, in the Arab world now, we have people graduating from baccalaureate, they don't know how to write a letter in Arabic, a formal letter in Arabic. They don't know how to write a line of poetry, to read a line of poetry, or know the meter of it, whether it is Tawil or Basit or Rajaz or Ramal. After 12 years of studies, can you imagine? It was in the past, my father went to a kuttab. He studied 6 years in the kuttab. First of all, my father, when he was around four, his mother took him to a lady, Khuja, in his area. She teaches the Quran al-Kareem and the alphabet and the basics. So he studied all of that, memorized Juz Amma, few surahs, few other short texts, songs. Then he moved to a kuttab. In the kuttab where he studied, he memorized Alfiyat ibn Malik, 1,000 lines of poetry in grammar, didactic poem. Even he studied for 6 years, from 6 till 12. You know what he studied also? He studied bookkeeping. It was called at the time Dobya, Turkish word for that. Bookkeeping at the age of 12, he graduated ready to run a shop, ready to run a company, a small company. This is how Sayyidina Usama ibn Zayd, he was 16 years of age, the Prophet ﷺ put him as a commander for a huge army. Attab ibn Asid was at the age of 18, was governor of Mecca. These Sahaba we narrate from, especially the three Abdullah, the Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, and Abdullah ibn Abbas. The fourth is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, was quite old upon migration. But these three, They were young people around the age of 10, 12 upon the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of them, when the Prophet passed away, they were around 17, 15, 17, 18 of age. They became great scholars. Even Anas ibn Malik himself, he was at the age of 10 when his mother brought him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be khadim of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we need to wake up really and be concerned about our children and how much time they're wasting. And try, don't just surrender to the system. Because here in England, the system permits you to set, let's say, exams ahead. If your child can study 2 years together and sit the exams of 2 years, even the year to come now, yeah, why save 1 year of his life, let him go to uni ahead of others 1 year? Because most of the educational systems around the world, especially in our part of the Muslim world, I speak about Syria and few other countries, it's made to waste the best years of the youth. At the age of 18, you have to enter school at the age of 6, graduate from baccalaureate at the age of 18, and know nothing. Still at the age of 18, you know nothing. At the age of 15, Imam al-Shafi'i received 70 scholars of Mecca gave him certificates, authenticated him to issue fatwas, ijazas, to issue fatwas at the age of 15. I don't go back. Myself, at the age of 12, I started delivering speeches after Asr prayer in Ramadan in Darwish Basha Mosque, wallahi. At the age of 12, my father used to write the speeches for me. 2-page speech instead of the wird. The mosque would be full like this, and sometimes more outside the Haram Darwish Basha Mosque. And the Imam Sheikh Abdul Waqid Al-Durubi, may Allah have mercy upon him, my father would tell him ahead before the Asr prayer, my son today prepared a short speech. The wird would take 10 minutes, 12 minutes. So instead, immediately after, wa alaykum assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, I stand up and start a short speech on Tawbah, on adab, on ghiba, namima, on things Muslims need, two pages, 10, 12 minutes. At the age of 14 and a half, I started delivering Friday khutbas. So, because of course there's a great master, a great scholar who took care of me and prepared me for this. Now you have to do it for your children. And if you cannot teach your children, the best money you invest is the money you pay to private teachers. You know Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, when his son memorized Al-Fatiha, he gave the teacher a huge amount of money. If I remember well, 10 dinars. They said a few dirhams are enough. He said, no, I'm celebrating this great achievement of my son, having memorized Surah Al-Fatiha. Have you ever thought of bringing a special Quran teacher to your home to teach your children? A special Arabic teacher to your home to teach your children Arabic? Or even if you want them to excel in their studies, an English teacher or math teacher, or this is the best money, better than the money you invest on a vacation, flying here and there, better than the money you invest even in mandub, hajj mandub. And Umrah and Ziyarat are mandub. Because this is fard, educating your children and protecting their deen is fard. When we talk about Al-Imam Al-Jazuli, yeah, his father took well care of him till at the age of, around the age of 15, he became a young scholar. He was qualified to go to Al-Qarawiyyin and pursue higher studies. In Al-Qarawiyyin, he must have spent between 7 to 10 years studied till he memorized complex texts. Texts like Mukhtasar ibn al-Hajib. Ibn al-Hajib is a great scholar in the Maliki school. He wrote a Mukhtasar in Usul and a Mukhtasar in Furu'. His Mukhtasar in Furu' is over 600 pages. Huge. And it is an abridgment of Tahdhib al-Mudawwana. Again, an abridgment of the Mudawwana of Imam Malik. Mudawwana of Imam Malik is in 16 volumes. The abridgment of it by Al-Baradi'i is in 5 volumes. And this abridgment of Ibn al-Hajib is one huge volume. And Imam Al-Jazuli studied this text and mastered it and memorized it by heart even. Just to see how much he excelled in sacred knowledge. He must have studied also there a poem on Al-Aqidah in the Ash'ari school, At-Tanbih wal-Irshad by Abi al-Hajjaj al-Saraqasti, 1471 lines. 1471 lines, almost at the level of At-Tamhid of Abu Bakr al-Baqillani. Or some of you might be familiar with Al-Mawaqif of Adhuddin al-Iji. The same level, quite advanced level in theology. And he used to teach this to his disciples in order to establish good arguments. But no one can outdo you or trick you or play with your mind, or no fallacy can pass in front of you. You will know each fallacy of anyone who brings fallacies against your aqidah to prepare his disciples to that huge level. Although he was studying to become a great scholar, his concern was more about the akhirah. He had a room. We have pictures of his room. I think the brothers will show it now. He had a room in the madrasa called Madrasatu Safarin, was also known as Al-Halfawiyin in Fez. The madrasa still exists till today. And his room, this is the madrasa. And these are a few steps that go to his room from the yard of the madrasa in Fez. And if you write Safarin Madrasa, double F, Safarin Madrasa on Google, you get actually the actual site of the madrasa in Fez now. You will see this is the madrasa from rooftop. And there are a few other pictures also. So this is the, no, not this one. No, this is the maqam of Imam al-Jazuli in Marrakesh. This is the maqam of Imam al-Jazuli in Marrakesh. Anyway, this is the map. So in that room, he had, allow me to stand up so that I can see everyone here. He had a small room inside the room. We would call it a closet, or sort of a small khalwa. So in that khalwa, Imam al-Jazuli didn't let any of his classmates in. They found it strange. With him, we assume Imam Jazuli being serious in his studies, so he didn't waste time. And usually people with huge big ambitions, they don't waste time chatting with people and playing and going here and there. So they suspected him that maybe he was working for some chemistry, alchemy, to get some gold done, or maybe he's hiding a treasure there, some gold. So they sent a message to his father. His father came and entered that khalwa, small closet, and found that his son has written on the walls, Al-Mawt, 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 death, to remind himself of the Akhirah while he is studying. This is not to wish for death, no. This is not a pessimistic approach that he's going to die, no. That's actually balance. In Islam, you have to work, you have to plan, you have to have aspiration, and you can work for your aspiration and wishes for as long as even 100 years ahead. But when it comes to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should be prepared to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the evening or next morning. So when you remember death, you remember that you're going to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your books will be presented to you. So how do you want your books to be? Full of good actions or bad actions? So then you look, okay, no, what I'm doing is wrong. I have to correct myself. This is the purpose of remembering death. Not that you remember it or to wish for it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam banned us, forbade wishing to die for a believer. So this is, we see the brilliant start of Imam al-Jazuli and where his mind was heading towards the Akhirah, not attached to fame. And indeed, we don't have much information about Imam al-Jazuli. What made Imam al-Jazuli famous actually are his students later on. In his time, Imam al-Jazuli, there was news about him, but there wasn't enough information about his life, about his family, about his teachers, about a piece from here and a piece from there have been written down. He wasn't very much interested in people writing his biography. He wasn't interested in going to the big centers and big cities in order to become famous. He was interested in guiding people where people needed guidance, in the villages and the mountains and the rural areas. This is why his biography is unknown, as one of his biographers, Imam Muhammad al-Mahdi al-Fasi, says. From Fez, he says, a Jazuri stayed in the south and all his students were from the south, in that mountainous rural area. This is why we don't have much information about him. After finishing his studies, Imam al-Jazuri went back to his hometown. We don't know where he worked, but he must have worked for a few years as an imam, taught in certain villages, until where he was, war erupted, so he was forced to leave his town. Whether it is Tankrut or another town, we don't know. The tribe where he lived was called Jazuna. It's a Berber tribe. This is why he was named after the tribe, Al-Jazuni. And this happens, I'm sure, in the sub-Indian continent, in Iraq, Kurdistan. We have examples of families who lived, families, Sayyid families, who lived amongst Kurds, for example. They were thought to be Kurds, and they spoke Kurdish, like Al-Barzanji family, for example, a great... Anyway, it's a great testimony to the importance of the Lagan in Iraq that these names are written on the wall of Ar-Rawda and Musharrafa. They were written by a famous calligrapher from Damascus, Abdullah Zuhri. This took place during the reign of Sultan Abdul Majid Khan Al-Awwal, Sultan Uthman, during the renovation of that masjid. From when you enter Bab al-Salam, all of these writings were done during his reign. So this is the beginning of the Dalail al-Khairat. But Imam al-Jazuri did not just do this. Inside the Dalail al-Khairat, there are hundreds of names of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and titles and attributes. And I counted them all, and I found them all together, 581. 581 names and attributes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside the Dalail. Sorry, 580. And 201 in the beginning, the total number is 781. And I made a list of all of these attributes. You can open any page. You can open any page in the Dalail al-Khairat, and you will see attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And we're going to read something if we find some time, inshallah. I want to point out to the fact that Dalail al-Khairat is a book of Tawheed. It has so much Tawheed in it. So against the common notion, the Prophet ﷺ does not fail us from Allah, he makes us love Allah more. Loving Rasulullah ﷺ and being attached to Rasulullah ﷺ makes you a better believer and more obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a principle. And Imam al-Jazuri applied this here. And he made sure that our aqidah is correct. He included here al-ilahiyat, al-nubuwat, al-sam'iyat, the three major areas of our Islamic aqidah. All of what we need to learn, what we have to learn, is included here. For example, the attributes of Allah. Adada, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin adada ma wasi'ahu ilmuk, wa khassasathu iradatuk, wa nafadat bihi qudratuk. Look here, talking about ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including everything, being the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, specifying taqseez. And this is a term of ulama al-tawheed. This is the terminology of tawheed. Then he speaks about qudra, wa nafadat bihi qudratuk. 25 prophets and messengers in the Quran, and Quran al-Kareem, they are all included here during salawat. For example, defending the doctrine of Ahlul Sunnah, establishing it. Just the reader reads and learns without arguments, without having to study. Allahumma innaka qulta wa qawluka al-haqqu wa Allahu khalaqakum wa ma ta'malun wa ma yasduru min ahadin min abidika qawlun wa la fi'lun إلا وقد سبقت به مشيئتك ونفذت به قدرتك. So you say that what you say is always truth. Allah created you and all what you do, and nothing that your servants do, not an action nor a saying, but your qudra has predestined it from before it happened. Establishing the Islamic aqeedah, beautiful. And apart from this, there is so much information about it. The miracles of the Prophet that are mentioned here, you could write a book about them. And the shama'il of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And last but not least, let me highlight the important fact about Dala'il al-Khayrat. Dala'il al-Khayrat is a book of tazkiyah, tazkiyat al-nafs. Although it is a book of salawat, but who actually is the best one who brought tazkiyah to us? It is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So embracing the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a way for tazkiyah. And he seeks refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from backbiting, ghibah for example, from hiqd, hatred, rancor, without telling us that this is a major sin and it is punished and we need to rid ourselves from it. No, just make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empty your heart from ghil and hiqd and hasad and all of this. This is why they say it's a book of purification, book of tazkiyah. And anyone who doesn't have a shaykh must read this book, because it's a shaykh for anyone who doesn't have a shaykh. And even in all Sufi tariqas, I have found out, mention the Naqshbandi tariqa, who do you want? Ahmad Sa'id al-Mujaddidi, the greatest masters of the shadid of the Naqshbandi tariqa embrace this book. In the Shishti tariqa, Mawlana Imdadullah, Al-Muhajir al-Makki, wherever he traveled, he would have with him Masnawi of Mawlana Jalaluddin al-Rumi and the Dala'il al-Khayrat of Imam al-Jazuni. In the Khalwati Tariqah, Sayyid Mustafa ibn Kamal al-Din al-Bakri al-Siddiqi, who spread the Khalwati Tariqah in the Middle East, was a master of the Dala'il al-Khayrat. The Shadili, the Qadiri, the Tijani Tariqah in Africa, every Tariqah took this book as one of the general awrad, al-awrad al-amma. You don't need a special permission from the Shaykh to recite it, but of course you always need izin, ijaza, to connect you to the author. And this izin has the spiritual secret. Because when Imam al-Jazuli recited this book so many times throughout his life, Imam Ahmad Zarruq writes in his book Uddatul Murid al-Sadiq, in our time there is a scholar in our time who was given salawat, the power of salawat, and he used to do everything throughout salawat. So throughout Salah, throughout Dala'il al-Khayrat, you can cure the ill. Throughout Dala'il al-Khayrat, and with Dala'il al-Khayrat, you can have your business flourish. With Dala'il al-Khayrat, you can solve any problem you have at work or any challenge you're facing. You can have relief through Dala'il al-Khayrat. And we hope that the sessions and majalis of Dala'il al-Khayrat are revived in every masjid, inshaAllah, in our community, and probably in your homes. Why not have a shaykh inviting him to your home and have a session of Dala'il al-Khayrat on a weekly basis? Or even you as an elder in your family, sit with your children, grandchildren, daughters, cousins, nephews, nieces, and recite Hizb of Dala'il al-Khayrat at least once every week to revive this connection to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because we see it is weak, it is getting weaker and weaker with the new generations. I'm sure that if you compare yourself to your children, you find a huge difference between you and your children, how you are attached to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how much they are busy with the dunya. We need to bring them back. This book plants love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shawq, yearning to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our heart. In this gathering, I give ijaza to everyone, although there is a master amongst us here who already served Dala'il al-Khayrat, mashallah, may Allah bless you and reward you. I have several isnads of Dala'il al-Khayrat. One of the shortest of them is from my teacher, my master, Sayyid Muhammad al-Makki al-Kittani, who took it from Shaykh al-Dala'il in al-Madinah al-Munawwara, Sayyid Muhammad Amin Ridwan. Sayyid Muhammad Amin Ridwan, who took it from Ali ibn Yusuf Malak Bashali al-Hariri.
And this is the second isnad that you mentioned in the ijaza of Mawlana Muhammad Abdul Latif Al-Funatli in his ijaza to you, mashallah. I read the ijaza. So the isnad I have is from Sayyid Muhammad Makki Al-Kitani, from Sayyid Muhammad Amin Ridwan Shaykh Al-Dalail, from Shaykh Al-Dalail Ali Ibn Yusuf Malak Bashari Al-Halili, from Muhammad Ibn Ahmad Al-Madghani, from Muhammad Ibn Ahmad Ahmad Ibn Muhammad Al-Mathni, from Ahmad Ibn Arabi Ibn Al-Hajj, from Abdul Qadir Al-Fasi Ibn Ali, from Imam Ahmad Ibn Muhammad Al-Maqqari, from Abu Al-Abbas Ahmad Ibn Muhammad Al-Sumai, from Ahmad Ibn Musa Al-Simlali, from Abdul Aziz, from Abdullah Al-Ghazwani Muhammad, from Abdul Aziz Al-Tabba' from Al-Imam Al-Jazuli radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This is a blessed chain, and let us make Fatiha for these great scholars who conveyed to us this knowledge. And before anyone, of course, Shaykh Abdullah Abdul Latif, Muhammad Abdul Latif Al-Funtalli rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiya anhu, my father, the greatest wali of Damascus in his time, the greatest scholar of his time, Shaykh Ibrahim Al-Ya'qubi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, to Imam Al-Jazuli, and to all the scholars who served Dalail Al-Khairat, who made endowments for Dalail Al-Khairat, who wrote commentaries on Dalail Al-Khairat, the calligraphers who beautified Dalail Al-Khairat, the artists who ornamented Dalail Al-Khairat until it survived in our time. There was always in Mecca, around the Kaaba, a Shaykh who was master of Dalail Al-Khairat. In Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, in Al-Rawdah Al-Musharrafa, there was always a master, a Shaykh of Dalail Al-Khairat. Around them, there was always a group to recite Dalail Al-Khairat. Things will come back, inshaAllah, if we go back to the roots of our religion. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mention him a lot. You want to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, send him salawat as much as possible. You want him to be happy with you. You want to receive his shafa'ah on the day of judgment. You want to drink from his pool sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want to see him in your dreams. You want all of that is in more and more attachment to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the easiest for you, you can study Shama'il, of course. You can read Shifa' al-Qadi al-Yar. You can read the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like Riyadh al-Saliheen. But the easiest and the strongest power is in this book, Dalail al-Khairat. The ulama say, whoever has a certain need should recite Dalail al-Khairat 40 times and he'll get what he wants. والحمد لله رب العالمين. How much time we have? مغرب is imminent. رضى الله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ما هو أهله. رضى الله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ما هو أهله. رضى الله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ما هو أهله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا الى يوم الدين. اللهم تقبل منا وقبلنا وعافنا واعف عنا. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم، وتب علينا انك انت التواب الرحيم. اللهم تقبل صيامنا وقيامنا وسائر اذكارنا، ولا تضرب بها وجوهنا، وبارك لنا في يوم عاشوراء هذا، وبارك لنا في يوم الجمعه هذه. اللهم اجعل هذه الساعه ساعه دعاء مستجاب برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. اللهم لا تدع لنا ولمن حضر معنا ذنبا الا غفرته، ولا هما الا فرجته، ولا دينا الا قضيته، ولا مريضا الا شفيته، ولا عاصيا الا هديته. برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين عمنا، واكفنا اللهم شر ما اهمنا واغمنا. اللهم اصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمه امرنا، واصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا. وصلي وسلم وبارك على عبدك ونبيك ورسولك سيدنا محمد النبي الامي وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. What is the gathering tomorrow?